Welcome back to Electrical Machine 2. It's still Joey Man the Utita. So on today's video, we just gonna discuss on four points. And then from those points, we also gonna discuss our memo solution to the practice test. And I will tell you what the funny story about that practice test. So as I said, we're gonna discuss about four points. The first one, we're gonna discuss about the type of excitation that we need to do in order to excite or to start our generator, okay? And then from this part, we're just gonna decide their representation, which mean how do we know that this is separately excited, this is self-excited, shunt or series. So we're gonna discuss those type of circuit. And then we're gonna discuss as well their representation when you're doing calculation. Can you see in the first point is when you are doing your test, you need to do their general representation. But in point two, the way you must think when you're doing calculation is gonna be different from the way you represent it. And then the third one, we're just gonna do a revision on some small basic like Ohm's law, Kirchhoff current law, Kirchhoff voltage law. I'm sure you know already it, but it's always fine for us to do a revision about it. And then we wanna do as well our memo solution, which is gonna be a funny story for all of you, but I'm sure we gonna have a good lesson today. And once we are done with this lesson, what's gonna happen now, we're gonna start with our solution to each tutorial question, starting from all the question for DC generator. So let's go with the lesson. As I said, we are going to discuss about the type of excitation and their representation when it asks in a problem. So the first thing that we are going to discuss is a separately excited. Why separately excited? Because we need an external battery, a source, an external source, which we call V field. What is the purpose of this V field? Is to induce, is to conduct a current. Okay, so once the current flow in this field, which is our stator, this is going to produce a flux. Okay, so therefore there will be a flux that is going to be induced now, as you can see. Okay, so you can see that the field current is proportional to our flux because we need a current to produce flux. So now this is our armature. Okay, so if you come now with motion, you rotate this conductor. This conductor will cut those flux, and then once those flux will be cut, there will be an induced EMF so that the current will flow. Okay, so we are going to supply a specific load, so this can be a specific load. Okay, so this armature is just our voltage, let's say our losses. So the armature is made of coil conductor, there will be some losses, so we represent that losses with the R armature, and this is our R field. We represent it to be our pole, our coil. Okay, so this is separately excited. Why? Because we need an external source to produce flux. Okay, and this type of excitation is not often used because we don't need an external source to generate. And then we're gonna have a look on self-excited. When talk about self-excited, it means we don't need any external source to induce, to generate the voltage. So what's happened here, because of the residual magnetism, which I explained in the previous video, why it is, it means in across our armature, there will be a specific voltage, a small voltage, let's say for instance, for 5 volts, that will be stored, okay? So by the time you come with a motion, you rotate this conductor will push those electrons to flow. So when the electron flow, what's happened is that now you're gonna have a current fleet that's gonna flow in your fleet. Okay, so once there will be a current flow in the fleet, because though our current is proportional to the flux, Okay. And therefore, this now is going to do what? To produce flux. And then once our flux it's produced, now the voltage is gonna be increased proportionally. So once the flux starts increasing, now we are moving from a minimum current to a maximum current. Okay? To a maximum current. And then we call it self-excited. Why? Because we don't need any external source to generate the voltage. So that's what's happened. Okay? And then this electron will flow to the load. But we give already some advantage of this series circuit. Series self-excited. We say this circuit, in order for it to operate, it needs to operate already with a load, because without the load, there won't be any current flow. Can you see? If there is no any load, there won't be any current flow. If there is no any load, there won't be any current flow. We need a load so that the current can flow back to the armature. So that is the disadvantage of the series circuit. And then when you look at another type of circuit, parallel, which we call shunt, okay? And then with a shunt, it's the same concept. Once you come with a motion because of residual magnetism, which means a specific voltage, let's say for instance for 5 volts, that will be stored across our armature. There will be a current that will flow from the armature until our field. So from our field, because of that current that will flow from the armature, which is the residual magnetism, there will be a flux that will be induced. So that flux that will be induced is going to increase our current from a minimum current to a maximum current. So once that current is increased from a minimum to a maximum, already we increase our voltage generate. Therefore, there will be another current that will flow from the armature, from our source. And therefore, we can see that we need to apply a Kirchhoff current load in order for us to have this circuit working. So we don't need any external source, and then we call it a shunt circuit because of the two field and the supplier that are in parallel. Can you see that? You can see that the two circuits are in parallel. Okay? And then another type of excitation that you're gonna have a look on is our compound circuit. And then when you come at the compound circuit, we have two type, long and short. Okay? So long and short, again, it's the same operation. You come with a motion to rotate this conductor, and because of residual magnetism, that 5 volts that was stored in our armature will make a current flow. Okay? And then this, because look, now we have two pole now. Can you see? We have two winding. You have this series, and then you have that field. That's why we call it compound. So this will induce a flux, and then the series as well will induce a flux. So now when we keep on rotating, we move a current from minimum to maximum, and therefore now we can have a specific generator voltage across our terminal. Okay, that's why we call it long shunt, because we have a series field and a shunt, which you put them together. Okay, and this is just a representation. When they give you a problem, they say long shunt, the representation you do like this. Okay, and then for the short shunt, it's the same concept, but it's just the way we connect it. When they say shunt, short shunt, it's and then we're gonna have a look on a compound shunt. As we say, the concept is still the same. You come with your motion, you rotate the armature. Because of the residual magnetism, it can be 5 volts. This minimum current will flow just to go to excite our pole or winding. Okay? And the purpose to excite those winding is for it to produce a flux. So there will be a flux that will be produced. And then there will be a flux that will be produced from the series winding as well. So when we keep on rotating our conductor, now we're gonna have a maximum current that will flow to that circuit and as well to that circuit, so that we can have a voltage. But this resistance here represents the losses in the armature. Okay? So, and again, that's basically the concept. When the lecturer asks you, short shunt, in representation, you're gonna represent it like this. But to make things easy, I'm gonna show you when you have to do calculation, how do we have to think, how do we represent them. Okay? So let's have a look. And all this PDF, it will be available to you on the website so that you can have a look on them and have access them. So when you are doing calculation, we should be thinking this way. Remember, the transformation from mechanical to electrical is happening to the armature. So which means our supplier, it's supposed to be the armature. So this is our armature. Why we take the armature as the supplier? Because the transformation from mechanical to electrical is happening on the armature. Okay? And then this is our losses, our armature. This is our field. But in the representation, this V terminal is supposed to be the load basically, but we represent it as a source. Can you see? So this is how you do the circuit, okay, when it's asked by the lecturer. But when you are doing the calculation, you think this way. And I give you those circuits to do some practice so that you can do your calculation. Can you see? So that basically what happened. So when you're doing calculation, this is how you represent your series circuit, okay? And then this is also apply for the shunt circuit. And with the shunt, the concept still the same. This is our armature. This is our field. And then this is considered to be our source. Okay? So when you're doing our calculation, we think like this. Okay? And this is also applicable for the compound, long compound. You have your field winding, serial winding. This is our armature, which is considered to be the source because the transformation from mechanic to electrical is happening here. And then this we consider to be a source, but this is our armature losses. Okay? And then it's also applicable for the shunt spanned, short compound. Okay? When you do the calculation, this is the representation because it's going to be easy for you to see that what you are looking for is the supplier voltage. And that therefore, this is our field winding. This is our series winding. And then this is our armature. This represents it to be our source. But when we do our calculation, we think like this. Can you see? So the idea is that when they ask you a question or during the test, you draw the representation from the previous video. Okay? But when you do the calculation, that's all you must think. You must think that your supplier is the armature. You're looking for the supplier voltage, which is the armature. Okay? But in the representation, you represent it the way we do it. Okay? Like I said, everything will be uploaded on the website so that you can download it anytime and you can access to it. So we'll try to have a look on this practice test and see what was the link. Already, as I said, this represents our supplier. This is our armature. Okay? And this is our field. So this is already a series circuit. So that's how you represent it when it's asking the test. You do this drawing like this. But when you're doing calculation, you think like that. Okay? So already you can see that this, you can apply this formula here to get the current I3. And therefore, the current I3 will be the same as the current I1 because it's a series circuit. The current will be the same. Okay? And then, so basically, when you're doing calculation for machine, it's all about Kirchhoff current law, Kirchhoff voltage law. Always apply those two rules. Okay, and therefore, when you're looking for the supplier, the rise voltage is going to be what? It's going to be the addition of the voltage drop VR1, VR2 plus VR3, and therefore VR1, you apply your Ohm's law, and this is already given as 460, and then you get the voltage rise, which is the supplier, and this is can be our armature voltage. So we were already solving a machine problem. And then we're going to have a look on question two. We're gonna have also the same concept basically. Kirchhoff voltage, Kirchhoff current law, they are the two methods we always apply. As I said, this represents our field. This is our armature, but this is our considered to be the supplier. But when doing the calculation, we represent it like this. Okay, so already we can calculate our current here because of those given value. We have I3, which is going to be the same as I3, which is going to be the same this voltage. Then you calculate your IR2. How you calculate your IR2? You can see that the voltage drop here is going to be the same voltage drop there because the two are in parallel. So this is a shunt DC generator. Okay, then you apply, and you can see this current will be the same as the current I2. So you apply on this junction, here you apply a Kirchhoff current law. So it's going to be I1 plus I3. Then you have that current I1. So you apply your Kirchhoff voltage law. You can see that the supply of voltage will be given by VR1 plus VR3. Because you can see that this voltage drop here plus the voltage drop across this two parallel will give us our supplier. So basically what we are looking here, it was the armature voltage. Okay. So already you can see that most of the concept that we are discussing here in this memo, it was everything about machine. So when you look at question 3, also the concept is the same. Okay, so this is our field, this is our armature, and then this is our supplier that is considered to be the supplier. But when doing calculation, you represent it like this. And then in the question, it was all about calculate R1. So you calculate your R3 using the two given value, which is the same as I3. And then you say that this voltage, the same voltage across R2. So you can calculate R2, which is the same as I2. And then you have your I2. You apply your Kirchhoff current law on this junction. And then you have your current I1. You apply your Kirchhoff voltage law to get the voltage supplier, which we say is going to be VR1 plus VR3, which is the voltage drop here plus the voltage drop there. Okay, so that now you can see VR1 is given by I1 plus R3, R1. The unknown is R1, then you get your value of R1. And then the total power, you calculate it, is going to be I armature. You can see I1 times I. So basically here it's supposed to be it's I armature, which is our I1 times the voltage armature, which is the supplier voltage. Okay, and then you do the same this like this for question 4. Question 4, also the concept is the same. You wanna just have a look, the concept is the same. The first thing they ask us is to calculate the value of R2. So you can see that this voltage here is the same voltage across R2. So you apply your Ohm's law, then you get the value of R2. And again, you apply your Kirchhoff current law in this junction to get the current I1. So I1 is going to be given by this. You apply your Kirchhoff voltage law to determine the armature voltage, which is going to be this voltage here. So again, remember the representation is this is going to be our coil, and this is going to be our supplier. But when you doing calculation, you represent it like that. And then when you look at question 5, the concept also is the same, but you can see that with question 5 they give us a short shunt because you have a field there, and then you have your series there, and then this is the supplier, and then this is our armature. Okay, and therefore the first thing you look for is gonna be when you're doing the calculation, the representation is like this, but then you look for IR4, this current here, and then this current is the same as the current I3, this current here, and therefore now you can see that you have another resistance, which means there must be another voltage drop here, VR3. Then you calculate your VR3 using I3. Okay, but remember when you have to calculate the voltage drop across the current I2, you must consider the voltage drop across the two. Can you see the two resistance? Okay, so which means VR4 plus VR3 is going to be the voltage drop across this. Can you see that?
Okay, so that's gonna be the voltage drop divided by R2. Then you get your AR2, which gonna be our I2. And then you apply your Kirchhoff current law on this junction here to calculate your I1. Once you have I1, you apply Kirchhoff voltage law. What is Kirchhoff voltage law? Our supplier, which is our armature voltage, okay, V, okay, it's gonna be equal to VR1 plus what? VR3 plus VR3, then plus what? VR4. Then you have your supplier voltage, the total power, you apply that formula, okay. And again, we're gonna have a look on the last example, which is a long shunt compound. When it's come to a long shunt compound, you can see already that this is our field, this is our armature, and then this is our supplier. That's how we represent it. But when doing the calculation, we think like this, and therefore you look first of all for your IR4, which is here. You look for that. Once you have it, you know that the voltage across VR4 is going to be the same as there. Then you look for R2, so you have the two currents, I2 and I3. Then you apply your Kirchhoff current law, you get your I1. Once you have your I1, you apply your Kirchhoff voltage law to get the supplier voltage, which is our armature voltage. Okay, and then from here, now you can calculate your total power. So that's the concept that I wanted to share with you. If you got time to practice, at least you're gonna see where you did the mistake and you're gonna start already improving easily. So in the next video, or in our next video that we're gonna do, we're gonna start already solving the tutorial question for DC generator. Thank you.